Dear participants, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends and colleagues, thanks to the organizers for this opportunity to discuss PISA, its contents and effects today in this really important conference, and of course giving me the opportunity of, let's say, giving some introductory remarks on the PISA negotiation, mainly well, the relationship between TISA negotiation and the principles of democracy and rule of law. I have to say, first thing, and I'm sorry to say that, I am not on the positive side of this agreement. I have to point this out because, let's say, talking about transparency, democracy and rule of law brings you automatically on the negative side, on the side of critics to this agreement. And I have to say that because I want to say I'm not an opponent of free trade agreements by principle. But we have to say that these free trade agreements, like TTIP, like CETA, like others, those FTAs, modern type, they are not only agreements about customs or custom bureaucracy to, let's say, abolish those. Wouldn't be a bad thing at all. But they regulate much more things. And that's why the content is so important. That's why the openness, the transparency of the negotiations is so necessary, because transparency and information, they belong to democracy. Of course, this is very clear to every one of us, and I am a citizen of the European Union, and there we have an article in clause 21 of the Lisbon Treaty, a wonderful regulation that is a pillar of the EU, of its institutions and its political strategies. And there it's written down that the principle of democracy, the principle of rule of law, is essential to the European Union. It's quite clear that this requires that important decisions, changes of laws, changes of political strategies have to be legitimized by elected representatives of the people, of the states, being parliamentarians, or, let's say, in some of the countries, being participating as people included in a referendum. But now let's come to the TISA agreement. We do, I think, know rather well the goals. The goals are to open up markets, to achieve free access to markets, of the participating countries for services, to achieve privatization of services and setting the rule for privatization, including a broad range of areas of services, public services, data transfers, intellectual property rights, traditional elementary public services. This makes it quite clear that this agreement is a very important one. It will affect not only broad parts of countries, but it will not only affect the group of friends that is negotiating the contents of the agreement, but it will change the law and the living and the working conditions for quite a lot of people within those countries, meaning, of course, and I'm speaking out of this point of view, in the European Union. And it's evident. And this is the problem, that the negotiations are not open for the public and they are not open for parliaments, at least not for those in the European Union, I have to say, and have to make this difference. I'll come back to that. This means that offers, proposals, agreements that have been reached in the meantime, because the negotiations are going on for 2 years now, are not published and they are not sent to parliaments to discuss them, to give the parliaments the opportunity to consent or to disapprove or to influence negotiations. Now, why do we ask for knowing more? Why do we ask for transparency about the negotiation? Well, again, for me, as citizens of the EU, is very simple. Important changes of law need democratic legitimacy. Let me say this again. And in the context of TTIP and CETA negotiation, the demand for transparency is expressed louder every day. You can see that, let's say, in a lot of demonstrations, of activities going all over Europe. And as I have learned, those demonstrations or activities are there to exist in other parts or on the other side of the Atlantic as well. So one can say that it's clear that TTIP and CETA require more transparency. TISA has been, as Hubert just pointed out, a bit under the screen of public awareness. But now it's mounting more and more into the center of public attention. And there are, I think, interesting things we can learn from TTIP and CETA. In the case of TTIP, we knew at least the resolution of the European Parliament mandating the Commission. This was published on May 2013. But we did not know the legally decisive resolution of the EU Council until the 9th of October 2014, not 2013. But some days ago, this decisive resolution of the European Council has been published. Of course, this creates suspicions. And of course, it's clear that this, publication had to be fought for. It was the European Parliament and the public protests that, achieved this. And now we are able to compare both mandating resolutions. And if you do that, you will find very interesting differences. They are more than remarkable, not only in underlining different areas of, the planned agreement. I'm talking about TTIP now, but as well on the question of democracy and transparency, because the European Parliament demanded very clearly to be informed regularly and in detail during the negotiations about office proposals and about reached agreements. And of course, they said that their intention was to discuss those and to influence the negotiations. But we know that these demands have not been properly met until today. It's only a small number of selected members of the European Parliament that were entitled to confidentially look into the documents offered in a special and secluded document room, and they couldn't take notes or copy documents. You see, my friend Hubert, he just pointed out I've been a long-time parliamentarian. I wouldn't have thought this in compliance with the role of parliamentarians at all. But of course they didn't. But the parliamentarians were not even permitted to discuss that, what they have read in public. And of course these procedures have been heavily criticized by parliamentarians, by the public, even by the Ombudsman of the European Union, one has to say that. But we have to state that regarding to TTIP, the European Parliament has not have yet the opportunity to discuss proposals or to influence negotiations. In TISA, if we come to that agreement now, we not even know the EU mandate. And this I find rather strange, because there is an EU website, of course. We all know it if we are interested in that. And on this website you find lots of promises about, let's say, transparency, but you won't find details on the negotiations. There is a paper about possible TISA structures. It's from, I think, September 2012. And there is a document an EU offer dated from November 2013, but this gives no hint to which directions agreements can be reached, offers are made, negotiations are running. And so, in spite of promising transparency, parliamentarians and the public do not know what's going on, at least officially. Of course, they have to rely to leaked, unofficially leaked documents, and that procedure, of course, is strengthening the suspicion that something is not correct in this way of dealing. But now let's come to the supporters of TISA. There are, of course, a lot of them. Supporters of TISA, supporters of TTIP or CETA, what do they do? They underline possible advantages. Well, they have the right to do so. But what they do as well is dispute transparency as a principle in international negotiations, and they dispute the role of Parliament and public in the same regard. They feel that what happens in the case of CETA is quite acceptable. And what has happened? You see, the finalized document of the CETA draft exists since the beginning of August of this year. But until today, this draft has not been officially published. It has not been brought before the European Parliament, nor to the, let's say, parliaments of the EU member states affected by this agreement. Not at all. And it possibly will, let's say, take until next spring that, let's say, those parliamentarians, at least in the European Parliament, will have the opportunity to look into it, to discuss it. But at that time, CETA, negotiations will be closed. You can see that even the protests in Germany and other parts of Europe are getting louder and louder. Canadian government has said, no, we are not open to prepared to reopen the negotiations. So what will happen is the following. Either the parliaments will give in, then we will have a public protest, even a bigger public protest, or the parliaments will disapprove the CETA agreement, so it has to be renegotiated. So I think that this strategy of waiting and not, including parliaments and public in the negotiation procedure of such an important free trade agreement is not only not in compliance with democracy, it's not really intelligent. If you really want to achieve a win-win free trade agreement. And you see, there are alternatives. We are in Switzerland here, and I found it very interesting that the Swiss government has, published the TISA document on a special website. I find this really interesting. And I know quite well that the US Congress requires and gets information, detailed information, out of negotiations, discusses it, and transfers its opinions to the negotiators. Well, we might not like this, but I think we can say that these ways are more in compliance with our principles of democracy and participation as the way the EU is handling these ways. And of course, supporters of this way of secrecy, of confidentiality, they say, negotiating an international treaty in full transparency is not possible. And we don't want to have that, but they are not right. As we know, there are lots of global agreements and conventions. I only want to mention the climate protection treaties that are negotiated in full transparency. And this is not only possible, it is, even useful, because the public interest can strengthen the procedures to come, some days to the goal intended. Well, as mentioned, the TISA negotiations do not follow this ways. And, well, suspicions are there, criticism is mounting, and of course, these suspicions are fired by that, what, let's say, supporters say. They promise not only that there will be a win-win situation, but they promise as well more jobs, economic growth, more wealth for citizens, and they do not differ between profits of a few and, let's say, the general growth for wealth for citizens. And, of course, well, people know, parliamentarians can read. They read that those promises, in the case of TTIP, growth, well, 0.5 in 10 years is not really important. And they know quite well that even the experiences with NAFTA regarding jobs and, well, decent work and growth is disputable. And of course it is disputed. But I want to say, if those supporters would be convinced that these are not biased agreements, one-sided, one-sidedly, privileging certain parts of the economy, but win-win agreements, why don't they agree to full transparency? I can't see any reason for that. No reason at all. And I think that the credibility of those supporters is undermined further by the clauses, well, illegally leaked. And we, of course, could read that clause, well, leaked some months ago. I think it was in the annex on financial services, about blocking the publishing of negotiation documents for at least 5 years after TISA has come into force. I think that this is the situation we are in. And on the other side, we have more indications regarding to TISA that privatization and liberalization of public services will include elementary public services in water, energy, traffic, education, health and more, that there will, or at least are intended, deregulation of financial services in spite of the banking and financial crisis, that there might be the danger of free banking data transfers, which we do not know, which we do not want, and the European Parliament has disapproved lately. And let's say some documents indicate ratchet clauses and other clauses that would not be accepted neither by parliaments nor by the public in our countries. Well, this might be a reason why secrecy is so completely put through. I think this might be an important reason for that, but this is absolutely contrary to the principles of democracy which we are committed to. Let me give you three more, let's say, points I want you to consider. First, it's not clear which the legal relations between TISA, TTIP, and other free trade associations are. What I mean is the following. I think that all these free trade agreements, well, concluded and in negotiation, have to be seen together, considered together, and of course, let's say, discussed together in open, because there are overlapping regulations, or there might be overlapping regulations. And parliaments and the public need to know which agreement contains what and which clause will prevail if different regulations are agreed upon in the respective treatment trade agreements. There are clauses, to give an example, concerning services in CETA, limiting privatization presumably, there will be, well, parts in TTIP in this way as well. And it might be possible that the negotiation does have to exclude parts or clauses from CETA or from TTIP. And of course, everyone wants to be very sure that they won't reappear in TISA. So this is why these questions have to be clarified before negotiations are concluded. Secondly, what about the very much disputed, chapter on investment dispute settlement? This was mentioned before. But what about this chapter and TISA? At the moment, there are no indications that this such a chapter should be introduced into TISA. But if this chapter will be taken out of TTIP and perhaps out of other free trade agreements because of the mounting public protest and non-compliance with the rule of law, will it reappear in TISA? There are some, you could hear them saying in Brussels, that the negotiation strategy follow a two-track strategy. That either TTIP will come into force, or if this fails, well, TISA will do the job. So it is very important to exclude this opportunity, and this is only possible by full transparency. And thirdly, at the beginning of my remarks, I mentioned Article 21 as one of the founding articles of the European Union. This clause contains even more. It not only commits the EU to the rule of law and democracy, but to promoting, and now I quote, multilateral solutions to common problems, in particular in the framework of the United Nations. What this means is quite clear. This means that the EU is committed to, let's say, global conventions because globalization needs clear rules and fixed rules, including the interests of all UN member states, not only of the group of the friends. And following the EU papers, TISA will be a paper negotiated by the known group of friends, but open to other countries. If you look to that on the legal background, this will be a plurilateral agreement, meaning it will be a different type, different in any case to TTIP, which is a regional free trade agreement, but nevertheless, it is not a multilateral, but it's a plurilateral agreement being negotiated by a group of states and perhaps open to others, meaning that those states coming later cannot bring their interests into the agreement in the way they could do it on a multilateral, on a global level. What I mean is that TISA, in this way, is some sort of a turning point in the EU foreign policy strategy. It's some sort of turning away even from the commitment stated in Article 21. And so I think, even if there are reasons for that, it is not quite clear what this will mean. You know, Hillary Clinton, she spoke about TISA as economic NATO. I found that interesting. The EU paper says that this plurilateral agreement shall be, well, changed into a multilateral one. But it's not quite clear which way the agreement will go. So this has to be discussed and decided by EU parliaments in full transparency. And I've not learned that this point has been in the public attention enough. I think it's a very important geopolitical implication of TISA, which we have to consider. Thank you so much for your attention. I am looking forward to learning more on TISA, on the content of it, but I am sure that the secrecy of the negotiation is a violation of the democratic principle of transparency. Thank you so much.